city of Tamworth here in New South Wales. Hello, everyone! What a good gang we have for you tonight. We love doing our town. We've been lucky enough to go all over the country. For some reason, three of the four towns all have tea at the start of them. We may make a slight change to that as we roll on, but I tell you what, we're very excited to be here. This is a great place. This is a can-do place. This is a joint that celebrates life, puts one foot in front of the other and kicks bad times right where they deserve to go, right between the black dot. All right, Andrea Carruthers is a lady who's been out here and had a little bit of a look around about what happens here. And here is part of the story of this incredible town.
Looking pretty damn dry, pretty bleak.
It's just something, that's what you do when you're on a place. It's, you've got to get up every day and keep going no matter what. Rain, hail, shine.
Some people were calling the Baraba Silo Water Diviner our lucky charm.
Mark and Sarah Ranger manage 4,500 acres, about an hour's drive southeast of Tamworth at Niangla. It's usually a high rainfall area, averaging 1,070 millimetres annually. But lately, the rain gauge has barely seen a drop.
Lately, I could not tell you, because I've stopped counting it, to be totally honest, just because it hasn't been enough. It hasn't been enough rain to worry about recording it.
A green tinge remains from a recent storm, but without follow-up rain, it's far from being a drought breaker.
Greened everything up, we got a little shoot, and nothing since. Now it's just like we've never had it before.
The ranges usually run 650 Black Angus breeder cows. Their herd is now half that.
Just have to try and be positive, and especially when you've got a family as well. Everything goes on to your children and they can see what's happening and they feed off your stress.
They're not alone. More than 99% of New South Wales is drought affected. 65% of Queensland is the same, as dry times grip eastern Australia. Today, the rangers are loading up 80 more cows to sell off.
So we've preg tested about 2 weeks ago. These ones come back empty.
In the beef business, when cows don't fall pregnant when they should, they're sold off. It's a cut and dried decision to maintain the most productive breeding herd. And in dry times, fertility declines.
When we joined the cows were in bad condition and obviously didn't come into heat and didn't join up as a bull. It's hard seeing your own cows go.
Carting cattle away and hauling hay to stop animals starving. Greg Collis knows all too well the toll this drought is taking.
When those breeding herds get down like that, how hard is it to build it back up again?
Extremely hard, you know, even sheep and cattle, you're going to be looking somewhere, you know, around that 10, maybe even 15 years before everything's back to a normal national flock.
Alone on the open road means thousands of kilometres staring into the horizon.
Extremely tough. This is probably one of the longest running droughts that I know of in my time.
At Tamworth sale yards, the ranger's cattle are going under the hammer.
Today, the Moonabar cows you saw have sold, you know, probably to expectations or maybe a little bit better than what it could have been. So they were up sort of close to $2 a kilo.
Here, the bids still fly in their ever so subtle way. But beneath the broad hats and stoic stares remains a painful truth. Rather than waiting for the skies to open, some locals are getting on with the job, putting towns like Baraba on the map.
We were looking for a project that would help bring visitors and tourism to our beautiful country town of Baraba.
2 years of planning, 4 weeks of hard yakka and 300 litres of paint later, Baraba's taking water divining to new heights.
The image on the silos is not of anyone in particular. The artist saw a number of water diviners in the area and created this concept.
But that hasn't stopped royal watchers from drawing their own conclusions.
Oh. Prince Harry to the left. Look at him, so identical. Prince Harry.
Is Harry going to break the drought?
Oh, no. No. I love it. I think it's fantastic.
The silo spectacle only just opened and it's already paying off.
Massive amount of people coming through, caravans, just people admiring it. And the town needs it right now with the drought and stuff.
For thousands of farming families like the Rangers, they know it's a long road ahead.
Some people might say you choose to live here, so why do you still stay here and keep going on?
Good question. well, You either love it or you hate it, and obviously we love it. Love the life, love the farm life. And that's why we stay here. And
you've got to take the good with the bad.
What a spectacular insight into what life can be like for many years. Very well done to Andrea. And also Scott Richardson was the man who was behind the camera there, and they often don't get a shout-out, the good old-fashioned camos, but there were some beautiful pictures. Let's talk to blokes who, well, they don't need the beautiful pictures, they live the beautiful life. John Jeffries, Matthew Kaluta. Lads, hello, welcome to the show. Thank
how
you very
you,
much.
Paul?
Give them a round of applause. Hello, how are we? Now, how long have you been in the rural game now?
I've been five generations out where I am. I'm just clicked up 70 years this year.
Wow.
And, I'm still enjoying it, but I'm getting a bit tired.
How does now compare to when you started? And I mean how tough the life is, how automated parts of it can be, the technology. How's it changing for better and worse?
I kicked off in 1964. I left school, did a 65 drought, which was supposed to be the worst drought on record. This is by far the worst. But I've enjoyed life. I've had nice modern machinery come through, and we've really enjoyed our life as we've gone through. And this is a bit of a hiccup the last couple of years.
What do you do when it doesn't rain?
Feed cattle every day.
What do you do? How do you find a way around it?
One of the things around us there is we've got a very, very close-knit group around us, Matthew and I and a couple of neighbours. I can tell when Matthew's getting down. I'll spend an hour on the phone with him, vice versa. And, we've got a very, very close-knit little group in our area, and it's only come together since the droughts hit us.
Matthew, when can you read this bloke, that this bloke's...
Oh, well... I just ring him up every now and then, and you can sort of tell. Sometimes he's just a little bit quiet and, yeah, won't talk as much or...
And in those moments, how do you pick the moments where, all right, just leave him be, just let him be, versus, no, I've got to step up here?
Oh, I don't know. Just carry on talking.
Yeah. What do you do?
Just say, yeah, I think, we're all in the same boat.
Yeah.
So no one's special. We all cop the same treatment.
Yeah, we're all fighting the same problem, so...
Well, that's the thing. I mean, what do you reckon the greatest misconception or... caricature or just sort of BS picture is that people in the city have about the life that you live here and what drought is like when you have to go through it?
The people in the city have really amazed me in the last... Well, since this drought's kicked off, we've had rural aid come in and help us, which is money that's come to us from the city.
This is by a bail, isn't it?
By a bail, great Aussie helpers, you name it. There's three or four different groups going. And it really opened my eyes up to see the people in the city open their pockets to give the farmers the help.
And how does that help end up on your land? What have they done for you?
We get...
He's the talker. You like it. No, keep going.
We get... we've had hay delivered into the area and a few other things, like, they give us a few odd fuel card and stuff like that, but... there's a lot of farmers for the hay that's been brought in, really, and we're not getting much, but we're getting the, how would you say, the support.
Yeah.
That's what we're getting.
It's not enough to feed everything, but it's a help.
Yeah.
Right? And it just cuts your feed bills down a fair bit, and it's a bit of support that you say, oh, well, people out there saying, well, you know, keep going, chug away.
How do you keep fighting? How do you keep finding a way to chug on?
Oh, I don't know.
It's just the way you're made, or...?
We all do it. Everyone has their tough times in life. We're sort of copping it all together. You look at they've reduced their herd by 50%. Mm-hmm. We're pretty much everyone's in the same boat.
Yeah.
And you have to make tough decisions. And every decision you make is a tough one.
What's some of the tough choices you've had to make because of this drought?
We were running 100-odd breeding cows out there, and the cows... Once you get big cows, they seem to eat themselves into a desert. So we've had to sell a lot of our cows off, and 90% of our cows are gone. But we've changed our program now. Instead of having breeding cows, we're just buying steers in, fattening steers and selling them off, or trying to fatten them in a drought if you can feed cattle and try to fatten cattle.
In terms of those little kindnesses that come through all of those different areas and the beautiful ladies of the CWA that we're going to give a helping hand to tonight...
Yep.
What's something that has just been a nice little, dare I say, luxury at a time when you're cutting back on luxuries?
I don't know. Just
you can't really put it into one.
Manicure, pedicure, you know, all the usual stuff that you love.
This old face, I got luck. I got makeup on tonight. That's a luxury.
You'll get used to it. Yeah. You didn't think when you woke up today you'll be wearing makeup tonight,
no,
did you?
No, we're throwing hay out the cattle this morning. Matthew conned me into coming in. So.
Well done, Matthew. You did the right thing.
No, no
For the Lexical thing, what's something you want people who are watching us around the country to understand about life here and about what they can do to help or how sometimes they can back off a bit? What's the stuff that you want people watching at home to know about life for you here?
I think, I don't know, the drought's still going. It's going to take a long time to rebuild. Whether it's escaped the mainstream media, which it probably has, and I think they don't realise that it's going to affect them. It's not just affecting us. We're the front line, we're copping it first, then it filters down. And it will get there to the cities eventually, whether your food goes up in price and it won't be available. Like, you know, you've got to look at our national herd, it's copped the pound.
But I like what Matt just said, though, about people in the cities need to understand that there is a direct line between what happens here and the lifestyle that they get to live.
Yep.
The most basic is price, but also availability. There's a whole lot of things that are a direct line, aren't there?
There is, yes. I virtually nearly apologised to a guy the other day. One of the major companies in town I deal with, used to deal with on a weekly basis. I haven't been in his business for 6 months.
Wow.
We've just shut our books down and just not spending money. And that's an indirect feed into Tamworth, which indirectly is going to go into the city areas. It's the farmers that just shut their books up completely.
And this is our message every time we do this show, every time we go around the country. While it's great to sit there, watch the beautiful pictures, hear from blokes like this, get off your backside and come here. It's the best thing you can do. Make sure that we keep, you know, when you go to in Peel Street, go to the RM store, buy some stuff there. You know, go and buy something from a local pub here. Go to a local restaurant. Book a few days whenever you get the chance. That's lads, thank you very much. Tamworth's very proud of you. Yeah. Good on you, boys. Thank you very much. Thank you to John. Thank you to Matt. Now, as you know, every time when we roll into town, we want to make sure that there is a genuine lasting effect from being here. And that's when the good people of Harvey Norman get together with the Country Women's Association. I promise no eggs were harmed in the filming of this story.
Off your dot and get to Harvey Norman now. Let's do a silent auction in the store for a few days to raise money for the CWA.
Great.
Help them by coming to Harvey Norman today.
Don't worry, I made his.
Thank you very much.
Shani, if you're listening, we're moving to Tamworth. We'll do it now. Well, we've got some family in Armidale, so we're more than happy to always be here, always check it out. You win, they win, and everyone gets a smile. So do it for your region.
Welcome. Let's see.
Oh, man, you don't want more.
Always a bit of fun, and great to have a chat to Scotty as well. There we go, straight in. Hook it, guys. Thank you, production team. I love you very, very much. All right. Thank you to Scotty and the team at 2TM who joined us and supported us at the station as well. I know Scotty's a big supporter of ours and we are right back at him. All right, let's have a chat to Beryl Mannion, ladies and gentlemen, from the CWA. How good are the CWA, ladies? Hello, Beryl. How are you? Hello. This is how committed you were. You were here 3 hours before the broadcast. Your beautiful husband's there as well. You know, you are committed. We love this here. Beryl, what does the CWA do in and around Tamworth?
What's the name? They support the people who are doing it tough. I'm from just down the road at Corindai, and we've been giving out... Money has been coming in. We give out vouchers which go for things like fuel on our IGA store, on the chemist, on various businesses in town, which therefore keep those businesses going, keep the keep the young kids employed that are working there.
Because that's the thing, Beryl, isn't it? It's about flow-on effects and also we've learnt after doing this show, working with Harvey Norman, working with the CWA, it's about learning that if you can do something to mean that normal can continue for people, that's really important, isn't it?
It's very important that they can have some hope that things will get better. We've had this rain the last weekend, but the farmers are going to have the situation where, OK, if things go all right, we get another bit of follow-up rain, they may get a crop in later on the year, but they don't get paid until December or January, so they've got to somehow or other battle through till then. We've got a little bit of rain, the rain brought a little bit of grass through, but they've got to feed their cattle through the winter. And it's the families of those people who are doing it tough.
Well, and it's that thing, and it's why we've been talking about how the drought, it still bites here. I mean, Harry and Megan, when they rocked into Dubbo, it was raining that afternoon, and I sort of was a bit... I was a bit sort of cut both ways about that because it was great that there was some rain that was falling, but that wasn't drought-breaking rain. That didn't change anything. And that's always the thing that we've got to remind people that, you know, yeah, sure, we crest with big concerts and big appeals all the time. You know, the rubber's hitting the road now, or dare I say lack of it at times. Give me an idea about the sorts of amounts of money that you help people with, be it small financial grants, a fuel card. What's the sort of tangible money-wise support that you can give people?
We generally give out vouchers of $200, like there's $200 in the vouchers. It could be $50 in fuel, but living at Quirindi, if somebody has to come to Tamworth to a specialist appointment, $50 might be lucky to get you to Tamworth and maybe a cup of tea while you're there.
What if I was able to tell you that there's a chance we might be able to help you out tonight, thanks to the good people of Harvey Norman, and most importantly as well, not just the franchisees of that store, but the good people of Tamworth who did an awful lot of bidding in silent auctions, where you could have one or two extra to hand out. Would you be pleased with this?
Oh, definitely. Be wonderful.
What if it was $35,241.35? Wow. How good's that, darling?
Thank you.
How good's that, darling?
That is absolutely fantastic.
I reckon we can do okay with 35 grand, right?
I'm sure you can, yes. And when you work out, like, packages of $200 into that 35,000, think of all the people that you're going to help. It's not going to make a big difference, but it's going to give people a bit of hope.
That's it, and that's the point. It's a bit of hope, a bit of goodwill to show that not just people in the town care, not just that a business like Harvey Norman cares. We care on Sky News. Everyone watching cares. Strength and love to you. And there's one last thing that I ask before I can give you the money.
What's that?
Can I give you a cuddle?
Oh, I suppose you can.
All right. Thank you. Good on you, mate.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's wonderful.
Thank you. Congratulations.
Thank you for coming to Tamworth.
Pleasure. Good on you, Beryl. Give it up for the CWA and beautiful Beryl. 35,000, that's really awesome. Well done to our mates at Harvey Norman, customers as well. Now, I've got a special treat for you, Tamworth. Conrad Sewell. Conrad Sewell is a once-in-a-generation talent. I've had the chance to see him with my own eyes perform. I'm so excited you get to see it tonight. This bloke is on the up, 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 and he'll find a new way to touch the stars. This bloke is about to perform Healing Hands for us. You know him as a man who won an ARIA a couple of years ago. He's got a new album, which he's very proud and put an awful lot of work into, which is called Life, which comes out the day before the election. So we can all smile before we have to vote. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Conrad Sewell in Tamworth.
What's up, everyone?
Oh, yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4. I know I'm not enough sometimes. I know that I'm too much sometimes, but you're still in my love. Yeah. I know you wanna walk away, but something in me makes you stay. I can feel it in your touch. I used to turn off my phone, used to never come home, ask me where have I been, and I would lie to your face, but I won't, no. I won't, yeah. Woo. Since you were there, some mark on your heart, never let go.
Harvey Norman, shop with confidence. Need advice? We're here to help.
Here we go, folks. Thank you very much. Welcome back to Tamworth. What a great crowd we have here as we are at Moonshiner's Honky Tonk Bar, which is a great place to be. And I can tell you what, the great place to be in venues like this is January each and every year with the Country Music Festival, just part of the tourism offering that is here in the great town of Tamworth.
It's launched some of the industry's biggest names.
I never work on a Sunday. I've got a life of my own. And this here now is the one day.
Kickstarting the careers of Casey Chambers and Keith Urban.
This is the end to a lot of hard work and the start of a hell of a lot more, but I'm looking forward to it. So hopefully you'll hear from me very soon.
The largest country music festival in the Southern Hemisphere transforms Tamworth into a music mecca, as an influx of big buckles, big hats and even bigger voices doubles the city size over 10 days.
Tamworth is happening right now. We've got it going on. Got my best buddy here. It's live. It's full of energy.
The festival means more to Elise Simmons than most. The Tamworth local always dreamt of taking the stage at the coveted Golden Guitar Awards.
When we turned 12, we were allowed to go for the first time. And so sitting there looking up at the stars, you know, with dirt under our feet, because back in those days they were at the Tamworth Showgrounds, I just used to look up and go, I hope one day I am going to be up there.
Last year, she finally got her chance. Picking up a Golden Guitar for Female Artist of the Year.
Still makes me sort of my heart flutter a bit and I get teary because it's something that I dreamt about, you know, since I was a little girl.
But it's not just the sounds of Tamworth drawing crowds from around the world. This place is the equine capital of Australia too. Thousands saddling up annually for the landmark classic sail and camp draft.
If you think of the Magic Millions, it's a little bit of a similar concept where people can only compete with horses that they've bought from a previous sale.
There's no horsing around. This is big business. More than $7 million changes hands over the sale.
Horses for courses, I suppose. They're all looking for something a little bit different.
Buying the top price filly will set you back around $230,000.
You said you want to buy a horse. Do you think you might splash 230k?
Look, I'd love to. We'll see what happens. I might need a pay rise from there.
If that's got you holding your horses, this might be more your style. And no journey out west is complete without a trip to the country races. And here at Tamworth, the action's just as good on the track as it is off.
We're the largest training centre in country New South Wales.
Hosting 21 race meets every year, the Tamworth Cup is the premier event, held in April.
Mine is a custom dress to accommodate because I don't have much room at the moment. And then the bag I did myself and my shoes and my fascinator are both here.
We've got a runner in the first.
And how are they going to go?
Well, we hope he's going to win, but owners always hope their horses will win.
Do you have a tip for us?
Yeah, let's work hard and be good to your mum.
Now, it's everyone's dream if they get to come to Tamworth one day, if you're a country music performer, to be able to win one of these. We've got a real-life golden guitar that's with us right now, and a real-life golden guitar winner, and the man who hands the freaking things out. How good's this? Ladies and gentlemen, give it up for Ashley Tallis, and, of course, all things country music here, Barry Harley. Hello, everyone.
Hi.
Hello,
Welcome
back. How are you? Wow. Ashley,
yes.
You grew up here. This is your place. What was it like to win one of those?
It's surreal to win one of those. I grew up in a very musical family. I'm the third generation in our family to play music. And my granddad's, he's won 4 golden guitars. So as kids, we had them around our house. And as a musician and an artist myself, I always dreamed that I could get one with my own name on it. And to have 2, I picked up 2014 Qantaslink New Talent of the Year, and then the most recent one was Traditional Country Album of the Year, which I shared with my dad, who produced the album. So now we've got 3 generations of golden guitars.
That's pretty cool. No, no pressure on your kids when you have them.
No, yeah, well, I've just had a little girl.
Oh, well done, darling. Jeez, you look fantastic. And, well done.
Well, thank you. Makeup team's very good.
Hey, if they can make me look presentable, you're fine. Don't worry, the canvas is much better here. Look, Barry, people love country music in this area, but obviously I've been here when the population just explodes. You know, Maddie, who works with us here, she's lived in places like Arizona, been to places like Nashville, and she says with her mates every single year they rent a house and they just live they live like they're 22 forever, man.
22 forever.
What's this place like putting together that festival and trying to make it bigger and better every year?
Well, look, it's a very unique festival in as much as no one person or one entity owns it. It's owned by the community, all the stakeholders, and so it's really herding cats a bit, but in terms of getting them all together. But all the venues and the halls and over 100 venues, 2,800 scheduled events, 700 artists plus 400 extra buskers, it's just extraordinary, and it gets the whole community together. And to the region, it impacts about $50 million into the economy. So an artificial economy immediately after Christmas, where every other regional town and city in Australia would be begging for something happening in January, and we have it.
Now, Ashley, being a born and bred local, that all matters. How are you able to form and forge a music career here? What's the scene like if you want to be an artist who wants to write it, to do it, all the rest of it here? Because obviously there's the festival. Is there an infrastructure that's here for the rest of the year where people are drawn, where, look, we're not going to say Nashville, but it's on its way to something like that?
Absolutely. We've got a great lot of venues in our whole town here that are very supportive of music in general and country music particularly. Myself, I play throughout the whole year here in town. It's just hard work. If you want something and you work hard for it, and every door that closes, there's always one behind it that will open. So I'm very fortunate. You just put your head down, you knock on doors, get gigs, and just keep writing music as well. My dad, he's got a studio here, and we make all my records in town, and it's just really nice to keep everything in Tamworth for us.
And does technology, obviously now, I mean, I don't know whether I'm dating myself with things like Pro Tools, but the sorts of technology that exists now is pretty amazing, where essentially if you can soundproof a room, you're going to be able to replicate that experience. Does that help to be more authentic, to make it with Dad, to make it where you live?
Definitely helps me. I think, though, with the technology, it is great. We've evolved so much, but that also means anywhere in the world, anyone can be making music now. So it's still, you've got to make sure it's at a higher level because everyone's got access to do it. So for me to always create the best, it's around people who I can believe in and also who I know are going to pull me back down to earth if I'm getting a little bit out of my mind with creative ideas.
More synthesizer. Not in this form of music.
I can say we haven't even got a synth on the new album. But
good, don't.
We don't even own one.
Good, don't. Good, you're fantastic. Excellent.
For me, as an authentic to myself, that's the best way for me to create.
And it's this thing, Barry, where, you know, country music's gone through many evolutions. It's great to see, you know, a young person wanting to make traditional music, all the rest. How do you ride the fashions of country music? Because obviously there'd be some hardcores who want it played a certain way. There's some people who really want to fuse stuff that's borderline country music to say that it's country music in order to get the trophy to go on and go. How do you
I think, you know, what we've seen over 47 years is the music change organically. We as organisers or one of the stakeholders haven't gone out and said you can't play or you can play because of this type of music. But over the years, it's just naturally organically shifted. And the numbers of sub-genres in country music, or, as you say, the ones that are almost music, adds to the atmosphere and the excitement of Tamworth, because basically you don't have to be a dyed-in-the-wool country music fan to come to Tamworth and enjoy, but I'll guarantee once you get here, you will enjoy country music.
Bloody oath you do. Now, are you a little bit bummed because, look, you know, you've got great hair. I mean, what about Keith Urban and that mullet that he was rocking way back when? Like, fair dinkum. Like, clearly...
At least he's got hair.
Yeah, clearly the presentation part wasn't part of the conversation. Like, wow.
1990, he won Star Maker here in town. And funny story, my mum, who isn't a muse herself, but she's very, obviously, manages all of us, etc. She was the country music queen for Tamworth that same year.
Really?
And part of her prize in 1990 was to be carried down the street by Keith Urban with that mullet.
Well, fantastic. Well, pretty simply, I think we've established here, if you want to do anything in country music, you call Ashley first.
Yes.
All right? Mum, Dad, Grandpa, they've all got the connections. What a thrill to meet you. Now, you've got a brand new album that's coming up pretty damn soon. How do people get in touch? How do people see? Because a lot of people here, I want to make sure, buy the ladies' freaking album, OK? Where do people find
you? Thank you.
How do they find you?
AshleyDallas.com.au and shoot a message. As I said, it's all family-run business, so you're speaking to the person.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah. And don't forget, mention my name, pay full price. That's generally the way
that exactly right.
Barry, if people want to learn more about the festival, what are they going to do? The
easiest place is online, tcmf.com.au, and everything you want to know about Tamworth is there.
God love you. Thank you, guys. Thank you so much. Really appreciate it. All the best. Thank you. Tamworth, a beautiful place, very talented. But can I hold it just quickly? Yeah. I didn't earn it, but there we go. My very own golden guitar, or dare I say Keith Urban's. We'll send it to you in the mail. More from Tamworth in a sec. Conrad Sewell's next.
This program proudly supported by NAB. More than money.
Now, back live with Paul Murray.
Welcome back here to Tamworth and our town. And I've got to say, every time we roll into town, not only do we bring a whole bunch of fun, do something good for people, but every single person in the audience here. Now, I know Oprah gives away cars. I give away stubby holders. And you get one, and you get one, and you get one. Stubby holders for everyone when you come to an our town, all right? See if they do that on Q&A. I don't think so. I don't think so. All right, meat tray time, ladies and gentlemen, the finest collection of colon-filling meats that we've been able to get for you here this evening. You can eat it all at once, take as long as you want, but meat tray time. This is the boss's favourite part, the favourite segment. Has everyone got their ticket? All right. Are we going to have a repeat like last time when three people had exactly the same ticket? Let's see. No, well done, Talia. We love you, darling. All right, let's... All right. The winner is a blue ticket. Yay! E16. Oh, no. Come on down. Congratulations. Thank you. Does that look like a setup or what? The bloke sitting closest to me wins the freaking thing. Hello, mate. What's your name?
Stuart.
Stuart, what do you love about Tamworth?
Oh, it's just a great place to live. Good place to raise kids.
Yeah. Born and bred or moved in?
I've been here for... Yeah, since 78.
Jeez,
yeah.
Well done.
Yep, nearly a local.
Think so. Oh, yeah. Is he a local after 40 years?
No. Okay, excellent. Well, that's wonderful. Congratulations. That's a meat tray. Enjoy yourself very much. Can you eat all that in one sitting for me?
I'll give it a crack.
Good man. He's got five kids. Yeah, that's done. Thank you very much. Good on you, mate. Give it up one more time. That's good stuff. Conrad Sewell has got an album that's coming out just the day before an election. One more time, ladies and gentlemen, the great talent that is. Conrad Sewell, thanks to the good people of Sony Music. From? When did you work out this is what you could do, dude?
Well, pretty early, to be honest, man. I mean, I loved singing from ever since I can remember, and then maybe about 8 or 9, I figured I was just that little bit better than everybody else.
Humble, I'm kidding,
That's cool.
I just always loved it, and I got this feeling, the first time I ever got on a stage, I had this feeling that I'd never been able to replace with anything else, so that's sort of, this is why I do it.
Well, this is it. I mean, you know, you perform with Ed Sheeran. You've got the album coming out the day before the election, the 17th. There's nothing like standing on a stage looking at people like this and banging out what you care about, huh?
Yeah, it's not, man. And especially even in small rooms like this, you know, to people that really love music, it's kind of amazing to get to do that. Even if you've played in a stadium before, this is almost more special than that sometimes for me. So, yeah, I love it.
I love you. Now, help us out with the new album. I know that Dennis and the team at Sony are very proud of you, very proud of what it's done, the details that's gone into it. Is it that nervous feeling where the world's about to hear it, the world's about to get it? How are you feeling?
Yeah, it is, definitely. You know, I mean, I've spent 5 years writing it, so very nervous to share it with everyone, but also just excited because, you know, it's my whole heart behind it. And, you know, I'm hoping that it's going to change my life and, you know, we'll see what happens, you know.
No doubt that it will. I got to ask though, man, when you get into a relationship, does the person opposite you know that one day, if this doesn't work out, they're going to be a song?
Kind of, yeah, I guess. At this point, yeah, it's pretty obvious.
You tell them, it's like, look, darling, look, I've got a notepad here. Don't worry, I'm not taking notes about you. I'm taking them about me.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know, you know, I just started being... It wasn't until I started being brutally honest with my lyrics and my music that things really happened for me. So, unfortunately, it comes with the territory for the lady that I'll end up with. So, yeah, but hopefully it's all good things. Yeah.
Good stuff. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, Conrad Saul, what an absolute treasure. Thank you, brother. Thanks again, man. Congratulations, man. I love you, bro. Thank you, bro. All right, well, the album is going to be out. It's going to be out on the 17th through the good people of Sony Music. Plenty more from Tamworth in a sec here on Paul Murray Live.
Harvey Norman, shop with confidence. Need advice? We're here to help.
And it's Tamworth here, where we're having one hell of a good old time. Having a nice night tonight, we're happy. Good to see the family hotel here, moonshiners, honky tonk bar, I love it. All right, now there's one of the many things to come and have a look at here, and you noticed it before when Andrea was showing you the drought package before, some of the great things to go and see, that silo art. About an hour out of town, but worth having a look at yourself. If you've got anyone who loves the Instagram, believe me, no filters necessary because it's freaking good on its own, OK? These things are about 40 metres high. International artist was here for 3 weeks putting it all together. The art is all about trying to get some different tourists to come here as well, but it's a pretty fine piece of work. The spectators claim that the man depicted in all of it is Prince Harry. However, the artist who did it all said not so. The person with the spray can, if they say no, then no. If you're the bloke who looks like him, then we'll do all right at the bars here in Tamworth on a Saturday night anytime soon. Adopt a Farmer is a great idea that is being run around the country right now. It is a big effort, and Charlotte Mortlock has a little more detail on what is a very, very good idea that you on the couch can do something for people in places like Tamworth.
Teaching children in the city about life in the bush has never mattered more.
We think it's really important that the kids have an understanding of the hardships in the bush, and we talk about our food coming from the paddock to the plate.
In New South Wales, 98.6% of the state is in drought. The central west, far west and northwest regions the hardest hit. An exceptionally warm start to autumn is increasing water evaporation rates, which is why these school children at Bankstown West have dressed up for the Adopt a Farmer initiative.
We're also giving a corn donation so farmers can give us food and they can, like, go through this drought.
To support all the farmers that are there in drought and just to, like, encourage them to keep on going and to never stop believing.
Many of the 65,000 farming families across New South Wales, Queensland and Victoria are at breaking point. For those on the land, the increasingly dry conditions are having a devastating impact on families, communities, businesses and the environment. The campaign established by News Corp and Rural Aid aims to ease some of that burden.
The money raised from all the schools today will go towards giving $100 Visa gift cards to thousands of farmers across the country.
Farmers already registered with a Buy a Bale campaign will receive the gift cards. In Tamworth, in northern New South Wales, school children in Katingle know all too well what local farmers are up against.
At my house, we have very dry grass and we can't see any green.
We have lots of animals we need to feed and we don't have that much money for the food.
It's like it's never going to rain because it's hot and cows need grass.
Very cute, a very good cause and a very good cause for a Mufti Day as well. Let's talk to some of the people about how this works and how it can benefit people here. Please welcome Nick McCulloch, who is from McCulloch Bulk Haulage, Daniela Prius, I thought I'd get there eventually, sorry, darling, from the National Australia Bank, Claire Armstrong, joining us from the Daily Telegraph. One and all, hello, everyone say good day. All right, now... Let's start with you first, Claire, and about how this works with the Daily Telegraph. Give us an idea of how this project works and what you've been able to see with the upsides here.
Well, basically, starting 2 weeks ago, I hit the road from Sydney, went out through a whole bunch of regional New South Wales towns, met a lot of kids and a lot of farmers doing it really tough, and together with a bunch of partners and a charity, Rural Aid, which people have obviously heard of out here, we are aiming to raise $800,000 to go toward all of the farmers that need assistance. It's going to end up being a $100 prepaid Visa gift card for every single farm family that's registered with Rural Aid. And so, as you saw, a lot of kids today getting out there doing this gold coin donation day to raise money.
It's this thing, Mick. Give us an idea of how this sort of help helps.
Oh, it'll definitely help the community and the farmers. Every little bit helps. Doesn't matter how big, how small.
Yeah, it's this thing where, businesses here, you have your own business that has its complications, but obviously you're interacting with all these other businesses that are having their times. What is it like right now?
Pretty tough. Our business has totally changed in the 2.5 years that we've had no rain. Totally restructured. If it wasn't for the bank support, with restructuring loans and finance, I don't think we'd be here.
Because that's how tough it is, isn't it?
Yeah, we employ 70 people. There's 70 families we feed.
And do you feel that responsibility daily? I mean, because when you're looking at costs and it's squeezing down, that's the thing that...
Yeah, for sure. You take it as a responsibility to try to make it right for them, you know? Like, it's... you offer people careers and, you don't want to let them down.
Well, yes, mate, I can see it. I can see it in your commitment to things. And, Danielle, the thing I'm loving about NAB and the more that we're learning about them as we're involved here and certainly at NAB Assist is that people have this caricature of how a bank will interact with somebody in a regional business that's struggling. That's not the case for you guys. When people like Mick are... having trouble or trouble is coming in upon them, which is probably a more important way of putting it. How do you help?
Yeah, it's really important for us to actually get down to detail with the customer. Each customer's situation is so different and we really need to tailor an approach specific to them and their situation and circumstances. And it's not just about supporting customers in the interim financially. We actually look to broaden our horizons and really work on building community resilience. So, you know, the community, we've talked a lot tonight about this flow-on effect and how the farmers are one part of it, but it actually flows on directly all the way down into, you know, people like Mick who, you know, have their transport business and the impacts there. And we've built a lot of resilience in this community. We've come out to our branch network here and worked with supporting them on how best to support our customers out there in really difficult times. And we've built a lot of different initiatives around that kind of support. Things like opening up our employment support network for our customers. And that's something that's industry leading. We've got mental health support network for our business bankers out there as well, because we know they're doing it tough alongside everybody else in the community.
Because it's this thing where you're dealing with people who are very good at one part of their business, but maybe just need a bit of an upkeep or a bit of a retune in other parts of their business. Financial literacy is always incredibly important. How important is it in tough times to make sure that you've got the right advice to make some decisions and that also the people that are giving you that advice are genuinely compassionate to your circumstances? It's not just a line on a piece of paper and you pass, you fail. That seems to be a big approach of what you're doing.
Yeah, absolutely. That's the key driver for us here. It's really around making sure our customers are fully aware of the options available to them, but also the outcomes of those options and decisions that they make so that they're informed and can make the right one for their own circumstances.
How do they help, Mick? How do they help you?
Like I said there earlier, restructuring loans and... we went through a massive growth spurt in a different line of business and borrowed a lot of money. We didn't know it wasn't going to rain. And then all of a sudden, your profit margins disappear and you're just living one day at a time waiting for some money to hit the bank, you know,
like
pay your wages. And it is full on. A lot of sleepless nights.
Oh, I'd imagine, that's the thing. And I'd imagine too also, I mean, in your business, everything from cost of fuel, insurances, all the rest of it here, where, you know, if you're not hauling, something's going wrong, and then if you have to haul, the cost of doing that is through the freaking roof.
Yeah, and our profit margins just dropped away because we're just running heaps further kilometres empty. You've still got customers you have to look after. they don't care if you say, oh, I've got nothing to get there. Yeah. You want to keep that work, you have to be there to load that freight. And we supply a lot of... We're basically a rural-based business, grain, fertiliser and feed commodities, feedlots and that sort of thing. So there's a big downturn in that.
Because it's that thing where, I mean, Danielle, our sense of these things are that, you know, when you hit tough times, it's you need to restructure all the rest, but exactly as Mick says, I mean, there's huge pressure on a business where, yeah, I understand, but. How do you help them with either the relationships that they have with other businesses, how to negotiate better relationships between the flow-on effect of the fact that everyone is having a bit of a tough time, but everyone's got a bill to pay?
Yeah, absolutely. So for us, again, it's about building that community resilience and making sure we're connecting the right support network. So we are but a bank and we can help you with some of those account-based issues and we can do all of that for you, but that's not necessarily going to be the absolute resolution to your problem. So it's about connecting you with things like financial counsellors who can bring in the right support grants and the right network around you to really facilitate that support, and that will then feed out right across the community.
Yeah, it's that thing. Well, it's cool to see those kids today, wasn't it? Because it's important for us that'll be living in the cities to be able to say, we get it, we care, we keep caring, and that's what's important about, you know, the big offices that are located in the big cities and the homes of the people that are watching us tonight.
Yeah, and I think what's particularly important to remember with this drought is just how long it's been going. There was a whole lot of attention around it sort of 6 months ago when it was beginning to look like the farmers were headed for a bad summer. Now we're, you know, going into another season. And often I think in the cities, the community's really aware of a drought is because the price in the supermarket of something goes up, and that's the first that they're really cognizant of it. But by doing this kind of thing, getting the kids on board, and also, like, I've been around a lot of New South Wales the last 2 weeks and meeting those kids in the bush who are getting up at 5, 6 in the morning, helping mum and dad feed, getting on the school bus at 8, going to school all day, getting home and then helping feed cattle, sheep till dark as well. So it's about joining up the city kids and the bush kids and helping those guys support each other as well.
Look, you're going to be too modest about this, but Claire's a rock star and she's an excellent reporter who cut her teeth in lots of different ways, Townsville Bulletin for a long time and now at the Daily Telegraph in Sydney. You've spent time around people that have you know, done a tough in Western New South Wales and now here in Tamworth as part of this project. You've seen good and bad times in places like Townsville. What is it about people who live outside of cities that makes them so freaking awesome? I love them.
I think it's a couple of things. It's the fact that they don't expect anything from anyone other than themselves. So they're very resilient. They don't expect handouts. They don't expect any kind of outside support. They're always grateful when they get it, obviously, especially in tough times. But they exist in a way outside the city bubbles. So they have to be all of the things that are as dynamic and amazing as a city, but in a much smaller place, which means they come up with really great innovative ways to live great lives while being so far away.
You've also got the best bullshit detectors in the world. That's what I love. I love it all very much. Thank you, Danielle. Thank you, Mick. Thank you, Claire. Give it up, one and all. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
More information at NAB Assist is the way to find these things out. We'll make sure all the links are up on our website. Quickly, before we go to the break, I want to show you about the Light Museum, which is here as well. This is it as part of the Power Station Museum, that is here in Tamworth. Tamworth is, of course, Australia's city of lights. First place in the Southern Hemisphere to get electric street lights back in 1888, you know, up the road in Manila, where we did a show in Australia Day a couple of years ago. That's one of their many claims to fame. There's a large array of things to go and have a look at there. But if you get the chance, you go to the Tamworth Powerhouse Museum. Quick break and back with more from Tamworth.
This program proudly supported by NAB. More than money.
Thank you very much for watching, wherever you happen to be. Can I show you some of the beautiful stuff around here? The architecture alone here is just magnificent. I also love a lot of the Art Deco stuff that's here around some of the pubs and places that are around here. As you know, that Tamworth, for those in the room, founded in 1818, it's quickly become a hub. Peel Street is one hell of a historic place to simply just go for a wander. And if you get the chance to do it at night, because the way that this place is lit at night is just so magnificent, so infectious. The post office building, a beautiful one that built in 1886, and the lands office building in 1889. But As this town has grown, what has grown with it are some absolutely beautiful buildings. There are some wonderful pubs here, all sorts of really wonderful lifestyle stuff. And I tell you what, the quality of buildings that are around here is something to absolutely savour if you are a little bit of an architecture nut like I, including that Art Deco stuff. They've got an awful lot of it here and it is freaking awesome, including half a building that I might buy a little bit later. No, I don't have the money. But let's learn a little more about the tree change, which many people have been involved with, those who flew here, grew here, turn up here or stay here. Here's more with Andrea.
I live about 6 kilometres out of town on a beautiful rural residential block, and on a really bad day, it takes me 7 minutes to get to work.
You can sort of smell the roses now, you know, it's not as fast-paced.
Most of us dream of a tree change at least once in our lives, but few rarely take the leap. Paul Pearson and Kathy Dennis did.
I was driving to work one day in Sydney traffic and I decided I don't want to do this for the rest of my life. I'd lived in one place for around 40 years. And I sent my husband an email saying, do you want to do a tree change?
The mental health nurse and accountant were soon packing up their lives, shifting 400 kilometres from Sydney to Tamworth 12 months ago.
Even all the local people, they sort of treat you like locals, but it was very welcoming. That's what we liked.
Beating congestion was the start. Employment opportunities, another key factor, with the region experiencing demand for jobs in education, health, construction and retail.
We said then we won't move until we get a job. And then we turned around and we got a job within 6 weeks.
But the deal clincher was access to affordable housing. Tamworth's median house price sitting at just under $309,000.
So you bought this block and built. How much did that set you back?
For what we've bought now, it was probably under half the price what we would have paid in the outskirts of Sydney.
Paul and Kathy are part of a growing trend of city dwellers, leaving the burbs behind for the bush.
We lived on the coast for 33 years and moved to Tamworth 2 years ago because there's everything here, everything we need.
Anything you want to do, you can do here other than go for a surf, really.
Growth that's welcomed with open arms by rural communities.
Tamworth is such a beautiful place to live that we're really trying to double that population growth. We've got this ambitious plan to be a city of 100,000 by 2041.
Some of the major projects underway shaping Tamworth's future include establishing a rail freight hub, linking paddocks to ports and the rest of the world, a state-of-the-art astronomy centre, and a $17.2 million sporting precinct with a new athletics track, velodrome and equine arena, capable of hosting international competitions.
If you want to have good, resilient business in regional communities, you want people to be here because they want to be here, not because they've been told they've got to be here.
And you can see, like, just how quickly it's grown and how they've, I guess, put the infrastructure around it to support the growth, which is really important.
All elements enhancing the rural lifestyle which locals have enjoyed for years.
I love Tamworth because it's a regional hub. It's very close to Newcastle and Sydney. So, you know, with a moment's notice, you can be on a train or on a plane or in the car.
It is small enough that it's friendly and you know a lot of people, but it's big enough that not everybody knows your business.
Plenty of sports, isn't it? You name it, they've got it. It should be more rugby union, but that's my problem. They haven't got enough of it. Bye. See you later.
Back at Paul and Kathy's new place, the only regret they have is not moving sooner.
What would be your advice to other families looking to make the tree change?
Get involved. Don't go to a new town expecting it to all fall in your lap.
Well, just give it a go and take the risk.
Very nice, and always believe somebody if they're wearing a Terry Towling hat. It's always been a great idea of mine. Now, audience participation time. Everyone stand up for me, please. Find the nearest hymn book you can. No kidding. Just stand up wherever you happen to be. Everyone up, 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 up. All right, OK, we're going to play a little game. I want you to sit down if you have been here in Tamworth for less than 5 years. Take a seat, take a seat, take a seat, take a seat. All right, good, pretty loyal, all right. Who's been here for more than 10 years? All right, good. More than 20 years? Oh, we're getting down to this serious stuff now. Who's been here for more than 30 years? All right, you're not old enough, sorry, all your life doesn't count. All right, 40 years. Oh, this is going to get tired. 50 years. All right. Well, you're going to win again. I know what's going to happen here. All right, 60. Anyone been around for 60 years here? All right. All right, you all get a free drink. Well done. I'm not going to go higher. When I saw ladies in the audience, we do not go higher. All right, thank you. All right, you all get a free drink there. Just ask Josh, my producer. He'll be paying for everyone. It's fine. He's great. No, he's rolling in dough. Seriously, those Gen Y kids. One less smashed avo breakfast, mate. You'll be fine. All right, let's... the acting Lord Mayor here is Phil Betts. Phil Betts, give it up for your Lord Mayor or your acting Lord Mayor right now. How are you, Phil?
Great, Paul. Welcome to Tamworth and welcome to this magnificent region.
Thank you. It is spectacular. It really is. Now, I've got to say, again, there are people in my life that are way better at it than me, but I'm a bit of an architecture nut, particularly the Art Deco stuff. You guys have done a magnificent job of not just keeping it and holding on to it, but maintaining it and redefining it. I love that there are some beautiful buildings here that first time I came here 20 years ago were one thing and now there's something else. How important is it for the council that the joint doesn't just look like it always has but just looks $1 million up and down Peel Street?
Well, we try to preserve our heritage. It's just absolutely important to preserve your past but also to move into the future with modern buildings. But if you don't preserve that past and make it look absolutely smick on, it's, you're not focusing on the future.
Now, when you are dealing in a regional area, in an area like this, obviously the council concerns are pretty different than sort of some of the super urban councils. Do you still get the NIMBYs, though? Do you still get the people who say, no, we can't possibly have this one thing because if we have this development, it'll ruin everything? Or is it a bit more can-do like than that?
Oh, look, you get that everywhere, but I think this regional community is a can-do community. We're really a resilient community. This drought has really proven that. It's very, very hard-hitting, but I tell you what, we are a resilient community.
Now, I mean, one of the things that made me blow up so hard about council amalgamations, which has now been well and truly dealt with in New South Wales, but the idea that I can understand why things need to happen in Sydney or Melbourne or Brisbane, but they matter a whole lot more in regional areas because this is the most tangible form of government, isn't it? This is the form of government where, sure, OK, they might have a federal member, might have a state member, but this is the one that is actually employing an awful lot of people. How seriously do you take that, that when the council can, you try to take on as many people as possible, but people with proper jobs, not sort of, you know, endless website designers, but people who are actually going to do something?
Look, it's just extremely important because local government is right there with the people. You're representing, you know, right across the political divide. You are there, you're on the coal face, and it's extremely important to employ local people, engage local businesses as much as possible to keep the area vibrant.
Let's get a sales pitch going. If someone's watching us right now and they've gone, you know what, it took too long to get to work today, it's just a punish every time I want to go to the shops, why should they up sticks and come here?
15 minutes from one side of Tamworth to the other and you can get all your work capacity. Sporting, it's just amazing. Restaurants, we have second to none in New South Wales, I reckon. And just the livability, the friendly rural lifestyle is just fantastic.
It's fantastic. You OK if, like, five more people turn up? Is that all right? Are you OK? You're not like, not like 5 million. We won't get all of Sydney here, but just a little bit in the next little while. What's the challenge for this place? What's the opportunity for the next little while? How do you manage good to bad there?
Well, the challenge is water. We need water security, number one. And we're working with the state and federal government to look at building in the very near future, I would hope, another dam or pipelines to get that water security. But we're going to a population of 100,000. That's our aim. That's our objective. And we've got fantastic things that we're looking at. International freight. We've got the Virgin Flight Training College. We've got fantastic sporting facility. Just spent $17 million on an international, well, capability of sporting. And it's just a vibrant area that you've got to come to.
Good stuff. Thank you, mate. Appreciate it. Good on you very much. We'll say goodbye from Tamworth in a second, but we'll take a quick break and then we'll do that in a moment's time here on Paul Murray Live. Thank you, Phil. Around the country. We've had a great old-fashioned time here. What a romp we have had here in Tamworth. It's a wonderful place, I can tell you that, each and every time we do in our town. We love doing it here. Have you had an all right time? You're all right? Excellent, all right. Was it a thrill to watch my back for 2 hours? Was that just... Yeah, ladies, I noticed you didn't answer at all. Thank you. Thank you to everyone here in Tamworth. As we mentioned at the start of the show, I love this place because it's a can-do place. I love that it's a fire-up place. I love that our town is something where we get to have a bit of fun, celebrate, do some serious, and also show you some of the beautiful stuff that's around. And I just want to say too, well, I do have a little bit of time to say it, I really want to thank the team that make this thing happen. There's a lot of people behind the scenes that do incredible, creative, beautiful technical work. I really want to thank all of those corporate partners because, look, this ain't Channel 2. We need their help to do it. And the fact that they believe in us the way that we believe in them and they believe in this project means the world to me. And I'm pleased to say that while our time is about to come to an end in Tamworth, the next location for our town is going to be Whyalla. Looking forward to Whyalla being the next one we're going to do there. But we've got plenty in the chamber. Ladies and gentlemen, one more time, give it up for Tamworth. Yeah. We'll see you soon on Paul Murray Live.